A very good afternoon to all of you. With the grace of Almighty, on behalf of Tilak College of Science and Commerce, Vashi, I, Professor Chanchal Kaur, welcome you all for the third and last day of our faculty development program on research development, statistical testing, and data analysis using Microsoft Excel. I begin the program by expressing my gratitude to the chairman of Tilak Education Society, Mr. J. N. Kurup, sir, and our principal, ma'am, Dr. Anita Joshi, for giving us the direction. I would like to thank my FTP team members, Professor Sheetal Aditya and Professor Sarita Balakrishnan, for all the efforts behind the curtain. A critical component essential to good research is the accurate and efficient collection and preparation of data for analysis. Microsoft Excel can be a useful platform to enter, maintain, and analyze research study data. I, on behalf of everyone present at the webinar, heartily welcome the speaker and guide for today's session, Dr. Sakharam Mule, sir, who is working as an assistant professor in the Department of Statistics of KC College, Churchgate, Mumbai. Sir has more than 15 years of teaching experience. In yesterday's session, sir guided us in understanding the concepts regarding hypothesis testing, standard parametric test like z-test, t-test, chi-square test, and f-test. We also understood the concepts of ANOVA, correlation, and regression explained by sir. In today's session, sir shall comprehend research statistical testing methods through Microsoft Excel. I hope, like me, all of you are ready with your devices having Microsoft Excel spreadsheet open to learn. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. I'm more excited for the session because I got very good feedback yesterday from many of the participants. So without making or keeping them waiting, we will start a session directly. Thank you to Tilak College and management. Also, Principal Madam, thank you for giving me this opportunity to be here in your FDP. At the end, it is very difficult to say thank you and then end up the session because everyone is winding up. That's why I thought that I should put my thanks at the beginning of the session only. So I'm sharing my screen. So today we have designed this session in some different way, that rather going by PowerPoint presentations and PPTs. So I thought that at least I will go hands-on if everyone is not going hands-on. So people will understand that how we can have a movement or where are the options which can be used in the Excel for the data analysis purpose. So it is very essential, as Madam has said, that data analysis really makes sense when you are going for any kind of research or any kind of predictions. Yesterday also we had started with the same thing, and we said that it is we should have to have a very good data analysis so that my conclusions, my findings will reach at highest accuracy level. I will never say that results which are carried out or taken of using taken out with using sample or maybe by population, they are at 100% accuracy. But we are talking about at the highest level of accuracy. These are a few things that I'm just putting it as, these are the notes that everyone should remember. During my session, I'm going to use a few words of that alpha. I've kept alpha as a constant alpha, and I've chosen alpha as 0.05. Then I'm saying that p-value less than 0.05 is considered as significant. And I'm talking about two-tailed hypervalue is twice the one-tailed p-value. For points, everyone has to remember, and they will understand that these 3 points I'm going to use very frequently during my session. I planned this session by starting or taking up one case study. And the case study reads as, I'm reading out the case study. Hope everybody can see this particular case study and they can read, because we have chosen, today we have chosen the platform for the presentation as Excel platform. So it is, sometimes it is very difficult because most of us are not familiar with, very fluent with Excel. We know how Excel looks, but can we use it for presentation, or how we can use Excel for presentation? So I've used Excel for presentation rather than going by PPT. I've gone using Excel. And this is a hypothetical study which I've designed only for this particular session. And there is nothing as that I have collected data or I have done any research or have selected samples from any of the regions. Everything is hypothetical. And the study is designed, I'm just reading out the problem about study. The study is designed to study the effect of COVID on small retailers, that is groceries and medical stores in 3 regions of Maharashtra. So as we say that Maharashtra is highly affected, and it is whole Maharashtra, you'll find that if you go and check the site, so it looks red. So it is, we have taken the study from regions of Maharashtra. Data is collected randomly from 300 retailers. So this is again a data which is before you. It is a hypothetical data. It is directly generated on Excel only. So there is no relationship of this data with the actual data. So if any relation or anything similar seems to be there, then it is just a coincidence, nothing is. So everything, whatever variables I have used, they are just hypothetical variables. I've just thought on one study, and that study I have planned accordingly, and there is a proper design which I thought on, and using that design I've gone for a sample. So everything is hypothetical, and the sample which is collected before you is of 300 retailers. I have chosen this 300 retailers because most of the time when the researcher, most of the Excel sheets or most of the presentations which are coming out for testing, they are using a very small data sets, and they are teaching how to go for data analysis. But normally data analysis, when you are doing any kind of research at that time, you will find that your data looks like this, that it has variables. So I'm just listing out my variables. My variables, I have identified that state regions, that is, I have divided a region of Maharashtra into 3 regions. And I'm calling them as Western region, Central region, and Eastern region. Then I've taken the location of retailer, and I've considered it as whether he belongs to rural or urban. That is the second category. Then next category is average number of average change in number of customers. This is a new variable which we have introduced. So if suppose nowadays, as there is a COVID situation, so government has certain guidelines. So is there any change in average number of customers? So we have taken one variable, hypothetical variables, and we are seeing that how much change you have, you are expecting in your shop. So that is average change in number of customers. Then I've taken one variable, and I'm basic variable is average daily profit before COVID. That is one variable. And average daily profit after COVID, and are you feeling any stress, that is whether you are feeling stressed or not. So that is my variable. So as per yesterday's design, we can see that I can identify my dependent variable, independent variable, latent variable, and obviously confounding variables. But today this study is a very small study. So we do have confounding variables, but we are not going to check the effect of confounding variables. Certain assumptions which we are making about this data is that this data is normally distributed, because we are not going to test normality of this data. And we are assuming that this is normally distributed data, because as the time will not permit us to go for normal distribution testing. So I have assumed that this data is normally distributed, and I will start my data analysis using parametric test only. So that means I'm going to use parametric test. Yesterday we have seen certain test, that is t-test is there, which we have to study. Z is there, ANOVA, correlation, regression, and chi-square is my major focus of study. And prior to that, we'll go for descriptive statistics. I hope I'm audible. If I'm audible, please put yes in the chat box. So if I'm not audible, just put your comment as I'm not audible, so that I will read that comment and I will check if any technical issue. So on the basis of this data, we have serial number. You can see the data. It has it has 300 observations. Every observation has a precise response. There is no missing. You will understand that missing observations are always creating problems. So we have avoided so many things, and we have taken it at standard level. So cleaning of data is very essential. So I have cleaned. This is a clean data before you. What is that cleaning of data procedure says? That cleaning of data procedure says that if when you are collecting a data in questionnaire, so sometimes people give some wrong responses in some questions. So in that case, I have to re-correct it. I have to go back to the respondent and I have to ask him that whether he what you want to say from that particular thing, and then I will re-correct it. This is one process. Second is that there may be a typographic mistakes. So that also, hello.
सर कैन यू जस्ट एक्सपांड योर स्क्रीन जूम करेंगे आप अपने एक्सेल शीट को इतनी मच बेटर फॉर द पार्टिसिपेंट्स
ओके
थैंक यू सर
इज इट ओके Okay, this is data which we have. So it is a clean data. So cleaning procedure is very essential when you are going for any data analysis procedure. And everyone who is doing any data analysis, he should, or he is taking up data analysis from anyone, he should at least go through the data. Here my variables which I'm going to use is region, location, average number of customers, change in customers, then average daily profit before and after, and stress, which is measured in yes, no. So this stress variable is of nominal type. Before and after is ratio type or scale type data. So yesterday we said that it should be at least on interval scale. So it is on ratio scale. So we can say that we can go for parametric test. Average number of customers is also at least on interval scale. Location is a categorical variable, and two categories we have considered, rural and urban. Region is also a nominal or categorical variable, and it has three categories, that is western region, central region, and yeah. So this is t-test, and there are a few books in statistics which say that t-test is a small sample test, but as we are moving on Excel, you will find that, and moving on softwares, all the softwares which we are going to use, the softwares will say that I should use t-test in case of large samples also. So I like softwares like SPSS, they do not have any test like Z in their category, and they are using only t-test for either for small sample or large sample, because there is a rule in statistics which says that t approaches to Z when there is a large sample. So I have taken my first objective, and accordingly my first hypothesis, I want to use one sample t-test, and I'm keeping this session at very simple level so that everyone will understand. I have framed my hypothesis. Hypotheses are also at a very simple level. so that there is no statistics involved into it, and none of you have to be a very good very well understanding of statistics. If you have a best at least understanding of the statistics, that is sufficient for us. So my first hypothesis which I have planned is the average profit is almost of rupees 500 of the retailers. So that means my profit, I'm saying that whatever profit, very profit the retailers are earning, so that profit is at least of rupees 500. That means either it is they are earning rupees 500 is my target, that I have to check that whether the average profit is equal to 500 or not. Alternate hypothesis in this particular case is the average profit is different from RS 500. Now you can see that I have written that it as the average profit is different from rupees 500. So if I want to frame this hypothesis, this is a two-tailed hypothesis. That is, the first is there is no significance of difference between the average profit of the sample than from rupees 500. That means average of the sample is equals to 500 is my null hypothesis, and average of the sample is not equals to 500 is my alternate hypothesis. You can even plan your alternate hypothesis as one-tailed hypothesis. You can even say that average profit is less than 500 or average profit is greater than 500. So accordingly, you are choosing a left tail or a right tail test. That is, we are calling it as a one tail test. But Excel, you don't have to worry about Excel, because Excel gives you both type of test result. That is, it is talking about one tail test as well as p-value of one tail under one tail consideration and under two tail consideration. That's why I have given it as. In the beginning of my slide, I said that it is we should consider that p-value. You can see my slide where I'm mentioning that the two-tailed p-value is twice the one-tailed p-value for the alternate hypothesis. So everywhere, whenever you are checking these p-values, you will have both the p-values, and obviously you will be able to find that it is twice, that is, two-tailed p-value is twice than that the twice the one-tailed p-value. So this is a checkpoint for you. You can check it out while going for this analysis. Now I want to compare this. So I generate a new variable and I'm calling it as, that is, a test variable. So it is a test variable, and for test variable all values are constant, because I want to generate a variable which will have a constant value. So I'm just generating the values as let us say that my variable will have all five values equal to 500. So 500 means the mean of this particular case will be 500. And if I will use a t-test for the comparison of this, I can go to a data, check it out. I'm going to data and then data analysis, you'll find. And I'm using one sample, that is two samples, and my variable is, I'm choosing my variable. So let us say that any of this I can use. The procedure is profit. So I will compare, I will take any of this variable before, and the variable profit is of rupees, and the rural, at the rural case it is given. Then we have, and we'll click on, just we'll click enter. And the next one is, and this is your test variable. We have to take care of this. I'm including labels. What does this label means? A label is very essentially, we have to look at label, and you will find that label is nothing but hypothesized mean difference is zero, and output range I'm choosing. So output range you can choose either in your in the same sheet, or you can go for new worksheet. So let us go for new worksheet, and you'll find that my test value is, it's very simple thing to do. because most of the students, researchers, they are struggling for this data analysis. The advantage of Excel is that Excel comes out with some basic descriptive statistics which is required. If you still want to go for some descriptive statistics option, if I want to generate a descriptive statistics, then what I can do is I will go to data analysis, and this option called as descriptive statistics. You can see that I can select a range for the data. I can go and check the range, and let us say that I'm using this data. So it is before and after data for a rural, and then I can use this. Enter. Labels are in first row. Output range I have to select. So I'm selecting output range in, let us say that in the same sheet where I was, I generated my previous result. Let us redo it. Okay, there's some problem. The t-test data I'm selecting. The t-test. Enter. Then for output range, we have to select this. We have selected. And I want summary statistics. I want confidence interval, confidence level for me. And if I'll click OK, then I will get summary statistics. You'll find that I'm getting two tables. One is for first variable, and this is for rural. Rural retailers. It is very essential for you that you should precisely mention what exactly, what variables you have used. You can do some modification in the table so that it will look very good and comfortable for reading. We can see that it is mean, standard deviation, median, mode, standard deviation, then sample variance, kurtosis, skewness, range, minimum, maximum, sum, count, and confidence level. I think this means okay. There is one question that whether this data analysis option is available in all Excel or not. So if it is not available, then you can go to file, and there are options. The options, see, again I'm doing it. It is file, options, then add-on, add-ins, then here it is Excel add-ins. This is Excel add-in. If you click on go, you will find that it will ask you what you want to add, and there's an analysis tool pack VBA, and these two things are required for statistical analysis. And if you click OK, so it will add. Right, so it means that if I'm calculating, if I want to go for a basic descriptive statistics, I can use data analysis tool, and I can generate all these variables. That means all these parameters, that is, I can calculate mean, standard error, and it is on single click. I will again go for this. If you want to see, now I can use my first data. As first sheet has everything. That means it has average daily profit, location, average before. Now one care has to be taken that I should be very choosy while choosing variables in case of descriptive statistics. I should choose the numerical variables for that purpose. Otherwise, it will not work. So I have two numerical variables. That is average daily profit before and after, average number of customers. Then there is a stress I cannot use, location I cannot use, and a region I cannot use. But I want to segregate my data as per my region location. So there is one more option, and we call it as pivot table option. Now, what is that pivot option provides me? This pivot table option allows me to go for having descriptive statistics as per my requirement. So I don't require all the statistics, but I require very few, and I may require mean, standard deviation, but I want to find the mean according to region. I want to find out a mean according to location or according to stress. I want to find the mean. So in that case, I can use this option of pivot table. So I'm selecting my data. My data will have all these variables. So first is select your data in pivot table. You can see, please concentrate because we are on webinar. So it is sometimes it is difficult for us to concentrate. Now again, I will go for pivot table. Now you can see, these are my variables which I have used. Okay, now let us say that I want location. This is the location variable in rows. Here it is rows, and I have chosen it as location. Okay, then again I can think of calculating mean, standard deviation. So if I click, if I will go back and if I will click on that particular table, I will get my pivot table fields back. Then I will click here in column and I will put, say, a region, and I want this region in column. So I just drag it in column. Now there's a value field. Now what you will have in values. So I want values, and this is a before is a numerical data. Now this is here you can see that values you have. If you click here, you will get option value field settings. So in value field setting, you can have average, or you can check something else. That if you want to find out standard deviation, then you can select and otherwise average. So I'm clicking on average. I want average. So you will find that you are getting an average of all these before scores, central region wise, eastern region wise, western region wise. And even we are able to find out the average with respect to row level size rural, person belonging to rural and central region, what is his average profit, person belonging to urban and central region, what is his average profit. So I can do, and I can do some experiments here. I can find out my basic information about my data. So this is all about your basic data analysis. What we see that presentation of information or basic parameters or basic statistics. So if you want, I will repeat this particular case again. There's an option. Again, I'm going, please see to this option. It is insert. It is available in insert. Then there's a option at the corner. It is called as pivot table. So I will click here on pivot table. So once you have clicked on pivot table, you will find that I am getting one window, and that window is asking me that where is your data. So I have to select my data. So let us say that I will reselect my observations, and it is I want to select my data. So I will click here on this red button. So please click on red button, and I will select all the data. Okay, all variables. Or if you have option that if you want only few variables to be selected or some to be ignored, you can do that. Now selected all variables, then click enter. I want it on new worksheet. I will ask it in on new worksheet so that your data will not be disturbed. So you will get this option as a pivot table on left hand side to build a report is from the pivot table field list, and on the right side there is a field list, pivot table field list. And in the field list you will find that whatever variables you have in your data sets, the same variables are displayed here. And this is the basic information or basic areas where you can bring out your fields. So if suppose if I just don't want anything and I don't want to divide my data by any means, so I can simply write I want to. So I just want average. So this is the average. This is the average irrespective of your rural, western region, central region or urban. If I want to check this, that what is the impact? You can see that I'm dragging down a location and I'm putting a location here. Now you will see that there is a difference. I'm getting two values. One is for rural and other is for urban. So that means by simple change in my fields, I can do. Now see, when I want to see that instead of location, if I want to use some other variables, I can use that. And I want to see how what is the impact region wise. So this is I can go select my variable, okay, and drag it down. So you will have central region, eastern region and western region wise. Now if I want it to be done that I want as per region or as per location, and I can see I have simply brought a location in here in the field called as column, and then values, this is the value I have to take care of. Only one value I can choose, because most of the basic Excel, they don't allow you for multiple values, multiple parameters or multiple statistics in same table. We should have to have some advanced versions of Excel, and they allow us to do that. There are some add-ons which allow us to go for basic analysis. But you have basic Excel and you can do a lot of work in basic Excel, because most of the research which is happening in India, they're having some basic data, 2, 3, 4 variables they have. They are doing some basic analysis and they are comparing it and they are presenting it, because merely a statistics is not important. But the inputs from the person who is in that particular field and how we interpret that particular observation or data, that is also very essential from the perspective of any research. So I will never say that the statistics is going to help you in all the way for presenting your research, but it is your knowledge in your field. It will also make a sense when you are interpreting your results. This is all about your pivot table, and you can customize your table so you can have your own tables. Now we can move from pivot tables to our basic FDP which is being designed. So we have designed FDP from this purpose. I have just introduced you with pivot table option, because in data analysis you will find that data analysis do not allow you for any type of customization, because it is only summary statistics, and I may not require all the summary statistics. So I just require few summary statistics. So I will just instead of going for this data analysis option, that pivot table option is a very good option. Here again, you cannot have categorization of your scores as per your requirement. So you can do that in the pivot table. So that is the best option where you want to customize your table. You can do that option. We can use it very frequently. If you'll use it very frequently, you'll come to know that you can do miracle in that particular data sets. Now, as we have done our first analysis, that is first objective was of one sample test. And we have used one sample test to test the significance. We have a result with us. And what does this result says? This result says that we have, see from this, we have the values. These values are nothing but they are the t-test value and p-values. So we have two t-test values, that is t3 statistics minus 8.6212. Then p1 tailed value. And this is 1.9870. It is raised to into 10 raised to the power minus 16. We have to read it. It is in scientific notation. So e minus 16 indicates it is into 10 raised to the power minus 16. So that means it is very small value. If you will see that here, you can read this value properly. There is another t critical value. This is we were calling this as a table value. This is one tailed critical value, and it is 1.65. Okay, so you can say that I can compare a t statistics again t critical value, and the general basic rule for any statistical test, if you don't have a p value, then we say that if calculated test statistic value is greater than table value, then we reject null hypothesis. This was the rule. And on the basis of p value, we say that if p value is less than 0.05, then we reject null hypothesis. So Excel is very good software which allows you to go for both type of comparison, because you don't have to go for checking, you don't have to check the tables, statistical tables, because it provides you the critical value. The critical value is nothing but that is the table value. We can compare your calculated value. This is my calculated value, and I can call this as this is my calculated value. So you can call t calculated. You can do even some modification in your results. This is my p value. Instead of calling it as, I will call this as a p value, and it is 110. So if we'll do some modification, it will be very good, because anyone who is reading it, he will understand that what you want to say, because we should have to write it in our general notations. This is a t table value. We call it as a t table instead of calling it as t critical. Now this is t critical, sorry, t calculated, and this is t table, and all these results are of one tailed. So I can call this result as one tailed result. Okay, this is your one tailed, and these two are of your two tailed. So this is, I can write p value, that is p value. And this is two-tailed. Okay, and this is a t-table. Sorry, t-table. And this is again a two-tailed. You will understand if you go in detail of statistics, you will be able to. Now this is, we can say that this is again, I can say that this is your calculated value. So rather putting it as in yellow, and these two values are one tailed. So I can compare p value. Now p value, if you have a calculated p value, I say that my standard p value which I am going to use at alpha is, I am using alpha equals to 0.05. So if I am writing, this is equal to, if it is one tailed and I am comparing it against 0.05, if it is a two tailed, then I am comparing it against 0.025, that is 50% value. So I am comparing this value is less than the standard value. Then we say reject null. Otherwise, do not reject. You will see that what we are doing means we can do a lot of things here in Excel. I'm just telling you in the first test, and later on I will not do all this. So this is my interpretation, and we reject null hypothesis. So what is my null hypothesis? In the first case, it is one sample. The average profit is almost of rupees 500 of the retailers, and I was not sure about my profit, so I have written it as the average profit is different from RS 500. So we have rejected a null, and we are saying that the average profit is different from RS 500, and you can even observe it from mean, which is being calculated for this particular data, that is before cut data. Its mean is 412. It has a lot of variance. So a lot of variance means there's a lot of fluctuations in the data sets. That means you will find that some people are earning more, some people are earning less. So absolutely, you will find that you will have more variance. That's why we have to take care of equal variances or not equal variances while going for a t-test comparison. This is your t-test. Yesterday we talked about t-test, and we were saying that t-test is used for three purposes. So this is our first purpose, that if the standard value, some standard value is given to us, and if I want to compare it against some standard value, so I can use one sample. But these are the two very frequent tests, and everyone has to focus on these two tests. One sample test is not that much frequent, but two sample tests, either independent or paired, is very frequent. So I framed my hypothesis accordingly, and I'm saying that there is no significance of difference between the average profit change. That means I'm saying that average profit before and average profit after, if I'm calculating a difference, then average of that particular difference is not, there is a significance, or there is no significance of difference between, when compared between rural and urban retailers. That means change observed in a rural data set is almost same as that of urban data sets. That is my basic idea. And alternate hypothesis which we have written is there is a significance of a difference between the average. There is no significance, and there is a significance of difference between the average profit change when compared between the rural and urban. Understand my hypothesis. My hypothesis says that first of all, I should have to calculate a change. Now, change is either calculated from before after. That means this is my rural data, and I have before value is 482, after value is 520.56. So that is average profit. And then we have calculated the change. Change is here. I calculated change by taking a difference of 520.56 minus 482.82. So just to be on positive, to take a positive value, so I have taken after minus before. You can do it by taking a difference as before minus after, and you can apply the test. It doesn't matter. Only the thing is that you will find that if there is an increase in the profit, then definitely your values will be negatives. And I observed, I have taken most of the data as increased in value, or profit has increased, because we are talking about retailers in the groceries and medical. So that's why I have taken the data as the profit has increased, daily profit has increased, and I have taken the difference of after minus before. So you can do the, you can take a difference in other way around also, that is before minus after. Here I have two variables, and I can set, I have to test this independently. This independently says that I should have to test it separately for rural and separately for urban. And if I don't want to do that, then I can say that I can calculate, because I want to find out the difference, change in the difference of rural. I have to find out the change in the difference for urban, and then I have to compare that change of rural against change in urban. And I want to find out whether there exists any significance of difference between the change observed in rural data and change observed in urban data. So what we have done here, it is very simple thing which we have done. that we have a data of rural. Okay, we have a data of urban. So we have generated two more variables, and we are calling them as rural difference. We'll call them as rural difference. Then we will call this as urban difference. You can see that I'm calling it as urban difference. Okay. And I can use this difference values for the calculation. Now I calculated it for 150 observation, because I have 150 observations of rural and I have 150 observations for urban. Okay. And in that situation, rural, you can see that rural, we have we again have western region, we have central region, and we have eastern region, but we are least bothered about this particular region. So we are taking irrespective of region, we are comparing that, and just we want to find out what is the situation of Maharashtra, and we are interested in finding out the difference of rural and urban. So definitely we have some values, and you can see that these are the observations. This is eastern region. So I'm see here, and it looks 250, but it is not 250. Please note this, because this will just have 150 observations. You can see that I'm just counting my observations. There is an option called as, you can use one formula that is count, and count says that it will have a 150 observation. So if you want to check that how many observations I have in my data set, I can go and I can check it out. I have an option called as count. Okay, so equal to count values. So it is 150. You can check this. That means my observation, my data has 150 observations. Here it is 150, figure is 150, and we can say that this is I have 150 observation. Why 150? Because previously in my data set there were 300 observation, now it is 150. A reason is that I was having 150 from rural and 150 from urban. So I made the separate variable. This is the data arrangement we are calling for Excel. In Excel we have to do some basic arrangement of the data so that I can use it for further calculation. So I arrange my data, I segregate it. You can see my data in the previous. This is always the case that people have data, because nowadays they are collecting data using Google Forms. So they will get a complete spreadsheet and it will not have any segregation. So for using a t-test, I will take specific variables, and then I can use those specific variables for my for the comparison. So I want to compare as per my hypothesis. I was requiring a data for rural, I was requiring for data for urban. So I have taken a data for rural, I have taken a data for urban, and I have taken a difference of rural of before minus after minus before. Then I have taken a difference for urban, and that is after minus before. And I want to compare these two variables. So variables for the comparison is rural difference and urban difference. This I want to compare. This is my variable. Now how to compare, how to do this? Again, we'll go to data. You will have data analysis, and we are talking about these two things. Okay, t-test, two sample assuming equal variances and two sample assuming unequal variances. So there's the f-test, which is called as f-test to web-test, that is two sample for variances. It compares, or it gives me answer on whether my data has the same variance or not. So what I can do, I can use f-test. First of all, I will verify whether my data has variance, equal variance or not. If it is not, then I have to choose accordingly. I will choose my statistics t-test. So let us choose f-test. F-test is used to test the variance. My first variable is rural data, and I'm selecting. My second variable is urban. So we have selected second variable. As I'm using, I've selected data from the title. So I will use label. Alpha, I've defined it as 0.05%. and I want this on new worksheet. So let us say that it is on new worksheet, and you just have to click OK. So if you click OK, you will find my hypothesis in this case is there is no significance of difference between the variance of group 1. My group 1 is rural difference data and group 2 is urban difference data. So I can calculate, I can check variance, and there is a huge difference in the variance. You can even observe that variance is bigger in urban data than that of the rural data, and this p-value is again less than that of 0.05. so we reject null hypothesis and we say that data is not having a same variance, that is groups are not having same variance. So now what I can do, now since I'm choosing a t test, I have verified my data is not having equal variance. So in that case, I will go for t test two samples assuming unequal variances. Now we will also see that what difference we are going to get if we have data, same data I want to choose, that is first variable rural data, second variable again urban data, urban difference data. Hypothesized mean difference is 0. I labels are there, and this is again we will go in separate variable. So it is okay, and you will find that what has happened with this data. So it has assumed it is doing some corrections in the data sets, and some degrees of freedom we will lose here. So that is a basic idea that in all total observations are 150 plus 150, that is 300. And in case if we are using an independent sample t-test, then our degrees of freedom should be 298, but there is adjustment in degrees of freedom and it becomes 266. So there is a correction in degrees of freedom, and it will reduce. So if number of degrees of freedoms are reduced, so automatically your test statistics will be adjusted. So you can find that this is the test which is using unequal variances assumption. So if I will use a t-test and I will go for a t-test two sample assuming equal variances, if I will go for assumption of this and I will choose the same data, okay, and again output range we will select it from our previous sheet. So let us say that we have selected this, and let us say okay, so that we can okay, we'll select it somewhere, then we'll copy paste. So this some experiments and the few things which we have to take care of. Okay, I'm selecting my analysis here. I will copy it out. I will go to the data. So this is one. The first thing which we have done is assuming unequal variances. Second one we have done, because in the first case we have tested and variance is not equal, we confirmed, and then we have run the test. Now you can see the difference of the test, that is a t-test. It is -10.6863. It is -8.68. You will get a difference in degrees of freedom, that is 266, and here it is 298, as we were seeing. But almost there is no difference in the conclusion. Now this is very true that when we have a very large very small p value or very large calculated value, so there are very few corrections we get. But this can create a problem when we have data which is on exactly on the threshold. yesterday I talked about threshold, and somewhere I was mentioning that if p value is equal to 0.05, then what to do? Now in that situation, if your data is variances are equal, so it will either it will go down, that means it will be less than 0.05, and again you are doing a wrong conclusion if we have not tested variance. And if it is on 0.05, and if you are not tested variance, and if suppose that there is a large difference in the variance, so automatically you will not get an accurate results. In that situation, we may come out with the wrong conclusions, or some we will miss out on accuracy. So that care has to be taken while dealing with the data. So that's why it is suggested that if suppose if you feel that there is a now when I should think of such a type of differences. So rigidity in statistics is that you should do all these things. But if you ask me personally, then I will suggest that if you can observe a very large difference in the means of the values of two groups, in that situation, if you go any one of these, then I don't think that you will get a very vast difference in your conclusions, but you will get a difference in your statistic value. So it is always better to be more precise on the values so that nobody can question on your data analysis. So that is one suggestion. But if you want roughly, if you want to see the difference, then it is you can quickly just check the difference and you can proceed. But if you want to go for publications or if you want to go for your thesis analysis, in that situation, it should not be practiced that you will roughly say, you will roughly assume that it is equal variance, because everyone who is doing a data analysis, or if you are sending your results to some journals, in that situation the journal may ask you to provide the data, and they may ask you that whether you have tested the variance or not, or they may reject your interpretations or conclusions because you haven't tested it out, or they may ask you to go for testing of variance and again a resubmission of your test statistic value. So that is that will consume you some time, and it will be a stressful job. So once you have submitted again and again, you have to redo it and resubmit it. So that's how we go for a t-test. There's one more of t-test we have, and we say that our t-test has a third part. We were saying yesterday that t-test is used in three cases. That is, we have to think of a t-test in independent samples, one sample, independent sample, and there's an option to be called as a paired sample. Now there is no significance of difference between the average profit of retailers before and after COVID. Now yesterday I was saying that if suppose we have a data, and if we say that if suppose we have observations, and they should be paired means that there should be some relation between the variables. So either they should be taken on certain different time points. So same samples observed on two different time points. Now if you try to understand the data can give you a very clear cut idea that the same person, respondent one, is answering my question from rural, and the same person is answering for before, and the same person is answering for after. But if you consider the first observation of urban, this first observation of urban is a different person, but this urban person is also answering me for before, and he's also answering me for after. That means in urban also we have before after case, in rural also we have a before after case, and data is paired here by a time condition. What is that time condition? Time condition is before COVID and after COVID. So whether your profit, and I want to confirm that, and this particular analysis, this particular hypothesis is placed in data analysis procedure to find out whether the change is significant or not. That means we are always interested to find out that if I'm doing some experiment, if suppose in classroom, if I'm teaching to the students, and to even for the today's session, if suppose if I will say that I haven't tested you for your Excel awareness, but if suppose there is a person that who hasn't done anything on Excel, or he has a very basic skills of Excel, and today he is first time he is doing Excel. And after doing my session, if I again ask few questions on data analysis, and if he answers my question, then I'm observing very positive change that my session has made a contribution for understanding of Excel. up to certain extent. Now, whether that change is significant or not. So to observe that change, we use this paired sample test, and that's why this test has a lot of importance from perspective of many of the economists, many of the social scientists, because they do come out with some policies, they do come out with some rules and regulations, they do come out with some guidelines, and they want to see that before guideline, what was the situation, and after guideline, what was the situation, what is the role of statistics. The statistics can help them to understand that before, and the guidelines or rules or whatever conditions they have given, that condition has made a significant difference in the profits or the conditions what they are observing on. So now testing procedure is same. You will find that the testing procedure, you will always remember that I'm not going anywhere other than data analysis. I'm not telling you anything, any other tool which is also available here, but I want you to focus on very basic things. If you learn this, there are so many options which are available with Excel. But once your interest got generated here to do a basic analysis, or if you are able to do a very basic analysis in statistics, definitely you will find that you will do a miracle with your subject, and you are collecting a data on so many aspects, and you will do and you will collect your data. So here it is, two, you can see that a t-test, you can see that this is a t-test paired to sample for means. So there are three options. One is t-test paired to samples for means, t-test to sample assuming equal variances. We are seeing that this is independent. Then this is again t-test for two sample assuming unequal variances. So we have to compare this. Now my objective of this particular hypothesis is I want to compare a paired data paired by a single condition, that is COVID, before COVID, after COVID. So I will use t-test paired to sample for means. I'll click OK. It is very interesting here that I want my data, that is variable one is rural. So you can use rural, and you can see that we'll select my first variable. I hope it is right. It is G3 to G153, first variable. What about my second variable? My second variable is, again, click on arrow, and then I will click here, and I want my data, urban differences. Okay, so I want to go for paired t-test. Okay, now I don't want to compare differences. So this may happen that when we are doing analysis, so at that time we have to see that whether these responses are independent or they are paired. What I need to do, I have to select a data of before. Understand this. So I have a data here. Remember, when you are running a test, this is quite often you will find that we are making some mistakes. I am not interested in finding out the difference between urban rural, but I want to find out the difference between before and after. So I want to select the data of before and after. Now here I have selected a data before and after for rural retailers. Hypothesized mean difference is again zero, because we are putting a null hypothesis that there is no significance of difference. You can choose any other value if you are expecting that it is not possible to get zero. In biological sciences, there are some in some situations we may get a difference. We are expecting difference not exactly equal to zero, but we are scaling it to some values. So at that particular point, instead of writing zero, we write that value. But now here we are, we will get exact difference, and we're expecting that difference to be equal to zero. Then we have labels. I will always click labels because I have added labels in my data set. And again, I will select output range. So output, here you have three options, either new workbook means you will get a complete Excel workbook again, which will have sheet one, sheet two and sheet three. New worksheet, so you will find that I'm getting too many sheets here, that is sheet 10, sheet 13, sheet 14 and so on. So that is a new worksheet. And if you want that data to be in a same sheet, or if you want to give some specific options, now I don't want to go for a new sheet, but I want my data to be in some customized sheets. So I have chosen the option here, and this is your output range. Let us select it properly. So we are expecting, we'll go here and I will select some space here and let us try it again. Okay, let us choose it from the same data, same sheet. Okay, we'll do it. Okay, if I want to overwrite, I can do that also. I'm selecting in the same sheet, you will never have any problem. If you are selecting it from different sheet, then there may be a problem. It will ask that whether I have to overwrite. Yes, I want to overwrite because I have already copied my data. So I will copy this and I will go here and it says, what about paid? So paid mean this is my paid mean. Can find, I can like you can check it out. You can see that what is happening with the paid mean is the mean I am interested in. So before it was 412.54 and after it has increased to 469.72, whether the difference is significant or not. So I have a T statistics and it says that the difference is significant. The reason which we are which is talking about significance is that we have 150 observation in groups. So number of observations also make a sense or adds value for data to be significant. So if you have a small number of observations, then this difference may not be significant. But if you have a large number of observations, then this the small difference is also significant. Even a large variances, and if suppose one of the variable there is a small variance, in one of the other variable there is a large variance, then I may not get significance of difference. So these are the few observations which a statistician is always doing. So again, I'm getting the values as T one tailed, then again critical value that is 1.65, that is going to remain constant. Okay, then this is T two tailed is 1.96 somewhere. Okay, so it is a constant value we are talking about, and at 5% level of significance. And this is my calculated value. So calculated value is minus 29.99, and I can, on the basis of calculated values, I can say that calculated value is significantly mod of T value. We take modulus of T value, so it is a mod cal value. Modulus ka matlab hota hai, agar aap mod mein value dalte ho, toh you will consider that value as a positive. So it is 29.99 is significantly greater than 1.65, or otherwise in case of two tailed value, it is 29.99 is greater than that of 1.97. So instead to avoid this confusion, we can use a p value. So any of this p value you can use, and you can say, you can conclude, because this p value is very small p value. We say that E minus 65 indicates that 5.05 into 10 raised to the power minus 65. It means it is very small value. We normally write it as 0.0000. And we say that since 0.0000 is less than 0.05, therefore we reject null hypothesis and we conclude that there is a significant change in the values of before and averages of before and after. What was my hypothesis? My hypothesis was, it was talking about that whether that there is a significance of difference in the average profit of retailers before and after of COVID. So it is showing that there's a significant rise in the profit of retailers which are in groceries and medical stores because of COVID. Because it may be the case, the data which I have collected is a very hypothetical data, but I assumed in that way. So I have taken my data in that way. So it is just an hypothetical data, and our aim is not to study this hypothetical situation, but our aim is to understand how we can use different statistical tests. It's all about your statistical test. My next test is, I'm moving for the next test, and my next test is again Z test. So Z-test, yesterday I said that Z-test is not an option which is available in most of the softwares. So we use the T-test and we are using Z-test only for the comparison. Here Excel provides that option. And it is part and parcel, it is not a part and parcel of most of the softwares. But now, as we have mentioned in our content, that we should also deal with the Z-test. So Z-test is a part of your data analysis procedure. And now we are using Z-test. Z-test is used either to compare one sample. One sample Z-test is not available here. But one sample Z-test can be done as we have done for the one sample t-test, because one sample t-test option is also not available directly in the Excel, but we can do some modifications in the data and then we can use two sample to give us the value of one sample. So that is one thing. Second is for Z-test, again, what I will require, what we are saying for Z-test, it is there is no significance of difference between the average profit change. So I need to calculate the average profit change. So I have already calculated this average profit change in t-test values. So I will copy my data. You have to be very careful while copying, because copy paste is the option where we may copy a wrong data and automatically we'll find that we are doing some mistakes, and at the end we will not be able to find out where is the mistake. So that means I need to find out that this is the variable of my comparison, rural difference and urban difference. I will go to data, then my data analysis. Then there's an option called as Z-test, two sample for me. This is the only option which is available for Z-test. So it is again a variable which is for comparison. I am doing it a little bit faster because we have a constraint on time. We have to finish this FDP on time. So hypothesized mean difference is I need, and that is zero. Now you'll see that it is asking me a variable one variance and variable two variance. If it is known, that means it asked me to calculate a variance. So what I need to do, I need to calculate a variance for these particular two things. That means first of all, I will calculate a variance, because that variance I have to use. So I will calculate variance one, variance for rural, then a variance, understand this, it is asking you to calculate a variance because it is required in my tab, data analysis tab. It is asking for variance, so it is urban. The only thing which we have to care of, we have to take care of the test. When you are using the test, first of all, I need to calculate variance. I'm not testing it, but I would like to calculate. And what is the option for calculating variance? It is variance of sample, and I will select the sample. My sample is, I will select a sample. Don't use variable name for calculation. So just select the data and click OK. So you get a variance one. I will also require variance two, that is for and it is variance two. I've calculated variance two. Now I have both the variance. Now I can go for data analysis. This is the data analysis. I'll go to Z-test. Z-test is a data which is nothing but it is rural. And I will select, then I will select urban. Here I will select urban. I have labels. I have included labels. I will click on label. Here I will write zero. Here I have to consider the value. So it is either you will write here, that is 536.4654 known variance, that means from sample, and 1107.897. okay, and here I will select output range. I'm selecting output range, and listen that this is very I tell you that I'm selecting alpha at 5% only. So obviously I'm selecting alpha at 5%. So I've selected, just select a single cell, it will work if you are doing everything in your same sheet. Okay, so I got my data and results are is saying that I have a mean 56, then variance. Okay, and it is z is minus 10, and this is z. One till value is very small, one till value, so 16, this is 1.64 and this is 1.95. I can compare z against. You can see that if I will take this data and I will take to the t-test calculation, where we have done some calculation for t-test, and it is, just see the comparison, you'll find that exactly z value is minus 10.68, and here the t value is also minus. This is a t value and this is your z value, z statistic value. If you compare these two values, you will find that they are approximately, they are equal, and number of degrees of freedoms which is talking about here is 150, because we are talking about 150 observation in each case. So it is mean difference, we are expecting it to be a zero, and accordingly we'll choose the degrees of freedom. So but we can compare these critical values, that is z critical value against one tailed or two tailed, and we can come out with a conclusion. So this is all about z test. Okay, now when to use ANOVA. ANOVA is used that you will see that I change my hypothesis. As per my hypothesis, I should have to use ANOVA. Now what is my hypothesis? My hypothesis tells me that I should use ANOVA here. The hypothesis of ANOVA looks like that there is a significance. There is no significance of difference between the average profit change when compared between retailers of three regions. That means I want to compare it against three regions. So it is more than two variables I have to compare. So in that situation, I will require ANOVA and my t-test will not work. So I can compare Western region against Eastern region using t-test, Eastern region against Central region using t-test, Western and Central using t-test. But I want to go for simultaneous comparison, and I will use ANOVA. ANOVA procedure is very simple, and we are going for, I need to calculate difference. So it is difference, we are seeing that difference Western region, then difference is for, we have Central region, then we have difference for Eastern region. Okay, we calculate it as, let us say that it is after minus before. I'm using the after minus before wala formula. So I'm not saying that it is whether I should take it as before after or after before. I just want to calculate a difference. So difference anyway I'm getting by taking any of these. Okay, only change will be that of negative sign. I don't have to bother about that. So, and it is very simple. I've calculated three differences. So we can drag. We can drag this so that we will get. You can see that I have arranged every time I have arranged my data. Now in the comparison of rural and urban, I had arranged it as rural and urban in my columns. Now I want to compare regions, Western region, Central region and Eastern region. So I have arranged it according to Western region, Central region and Eastern region. So even I can include, I will just include a location so that we can go for another a type if required. If time permits, we'll go, otherwise we'll skip it. But you should know at least where is ANOVA. And let us say that how we can do that. Again, go to data, then data analysis, and there's option at the top only. And we want ANOVA, single factor ANOVA. I just want to compare. Is there any significance of difference between Western region, Central region, and Eastern region? So I can do that. Okay, and here you just don't have to bother about independent columns. You can select whole data together. That means all the three variables are considered simultaneously. Group by columns, labels in first row, always. Then I'm choosing option as I want this to be in my same chart. And let us say that I select it. selected it. Let us click OK. And you can see that a difference in Western region. So I get some basic analysis even that what is the difference in Western region, that it is average is Western region 73.79, Central region is 72.22, and 77.25 is for Eastern region. That is a change. And what is my ANOVA says? ANOVA says that it is not significant. That means change observed in region wise is not significant because this p value is greater than 0.05. Excel allows you to compare both the values. As I said, that Excel has this beauty with it, that Excel, it gives me a critical value. That means this is my calculated value and this is my table value. So at this particular respective degrees of freedom, I get two values. So those who are not comfortable with p value, they can directly compare f cal value against f table value. So it's very essential that you have to find your comfort and then you have to write your interpretation. So I say that if it is I'm rejecting my if p value is less than 0.05, we reject null hypothesis. But here the p value is not less than 0.05, then what to do? I'm not supposed to reject my hypothesis. So being a statistician only, I can say that we are suggesting not to reject the null hypothesis. So it's very essential step, because if your ANOVA is significant, then again we have to go for post hoc test comparison. Post hoc test is nothing but it is called as a pairwise comparison, but pairwise comparison is not available in basic Excel. So how to what to do for pairwise comparison? Even I can go and check go with the t-test, but there are some issues with t-test also. So if you have ANOVA test, only if you can confirm ANOVA is significant, then you can have a pairwise comparison of Western region against Central region, Western region against Eastern region, Central region against Eastern region, by using some post hoc test comparison. There are some add-ons in Excel which can be used for this purpose. So please see to this, that how you can we can go for post hoc, but this is the procedure of ANOVA. And if suppose I want to see the effect, whether it is confounded, and I want to say that this is the data, and data is let us say that this is whole data, rural and urban, and we have entered it as, let us see what happens. Per sample I have 50 rows per sample. I will go for output. Let us choose, and I will choose in the same sheet. So it is okay for me. I am choosing, and now I have, you can see that my data is segregated. That is, I have Western region, rural data, then average of rural, difference. So here you will get, is also a way of generating your summary tables. Then urban, then there's a total count, and you can see that a sample, columns, interaction. Okay, I need to read these values particularly. See here, I have two samples, that means rural and urban. So therefore degrees of freedom is 1, 2 minus 1 is 1. And whether the rural and rural or urban wise significant difference is exist or not. So exactly, there exists a significance of difference because this p value is less than 0.05, and even f calculated value is significantly greater than f critical value. So in that case, we can say that there is a significance of difference between the average scores of rural and urban. So as we have observed this value, in case of t-test also, that we have compared using independent t-tests, that whether the change is significant with respect to rural or urban. So absolutely, the change is significant with respect to rural and urban. Now what about region wise? Because I had kept my regions in columns, so that's why it is calling it as region. So there are three regions. These are the three regions. So that's why it is calling it as column. And if it is calling it as column, that means this is your, we can say that location wise. I do some modification in my data, and this is columns is nothing but it is region wise. What about interaction? That is region wise and assuming interaction with rural. So region wise, if you compare within a region, rural and urban, that means in rural, if you compare only region wise, or in urban, if you compare region wise, you will not get a significance of difference. And here we, this is called as error. So this is the standard format of your ANOVA. And we go for interpretation of this ANOVA. So this is the procedure, we call it as one-way and two-way ANOVA. So one-way, this is your simple one-way ANOVA, and this is your two-way ANOVA. So this is very interesting that what you want to do. That means you can see that if we are looking at our data sets, and if it doesn't matter that how many observations you have, only what matters is the how many variables you have. That really matters for any analysis. So that if you have very small number of variables and very small set of data, then I think Excel is the best. And if you are very precise on analysis part, so that is you can say that we can go for data analysis using such a parametric. If you have parametric data, then you can go for parametric data analysis. Now I'm moving for the next test, and the test is to be called as correlation. Now my hypothesis, again I reframed it, and every time, everywhere I'm putting my hypothesis so that you will understand that what I want to test. There is no significance of significance of association. Now we are shifting it from difference to association. So there is no significance of association between number of working this is not hours, that is number of customers. I am saying it is customers because I have used the variable as customers. Prior I was thinking of using a variable of R, so I framed it accordingly, customers, and a change in profit. So this is how I have average number of customers, okay, in my shop, and then there's a difference I calculated. It is changed. Now I just don't want to see it by rural or urban. Simply I want to do it. So I can go for data. I have option data analysis. Then I can go for a correlation, and I can think of my data, that is input range. Input range, you have to understand that which is your X and which is your Y. I have understood that average number of customers is my X variable. Difference is my Y variable, because difference is a dependent variable. Average number of customers is independent variable. That's how it become very essential for us to understand. And Excel understand its first variable as X and second variable as Y. So this is your X and Y. So that's why I've chosen number of customer as X, as it is independent, and Y as it is dependent. That is difference I'm choosing. So I'm selecting all my data. I've selected all 300 observations. I have selected, again I have labels in my first row. My data is grouped by columns. Output range which I want to use is here in my Excel sheet only. Same sheet I want to do the analysis, and I will find that I'm getting very simple. This is the correlation. The correlation. So if suppose if I want to calculate the correlation, I can use directly, I can use the function for this particular correlation. So that's how we can do the analysis. Correlation analysis is the positive correlation, and we interpret accordingly. So that's how we do correlation. So some of you may think that can we do any graphical analysis of this? So absolutely, we can do a graphical analysis, and it is very simple. That I want to find out, there's an option called as scatter plot, and a correlation is always but before going for analysis, I need to select my data, and then I can insert a scatter plot. You can see that I'm selecting it. Correlation, for correlation and regression, scatter plot is the best option. And then we have data. Now what I can do with this, you can understand that I want to find out what is the trend, whether it is positive or negative. So I can find out the trend and I can add a trend line into it. Okay, so when I add a trend line, I'm getting an option here that is, it is exponential, linear, logarithmic, polynomial, power and moving averages. So today our aim is only of linear, so we will not go beyond linear. And I can even find out that regression equation on same correlation plot, and I will ask it to display R-squared value. These two values are very important from the perspective of analysis, because we want, that is, if you have assumed that this relation is cause effect relations, then in that situation you will require to calculate the regression equation. We have other option of calculating a regression equation, but you can even use correlation for calculating. Now, where is that equation which I am getting? This is, here is the equation. You can see that I am getting the equation here, and equation is nothing but this is A is 47.473, and B is A plus Y is equals to A plus BX. So if it is a Y equals to A plus BX, in that situation, Y is equals to A plus BX. A is equals to 47.473, and B is equals to, it is 2.25. I have R square and it is very poor R square, that is 0.0805. We'll understand that R square is very essential for us, because R square can tell us about how much my cause effect relation is effectively going to predict in future. So it is very 8%. That means this is the only, x is the variable. I understand what is the relation of y and x. So from using this value of R square, I can say that the independent variable x can explain y only up to 8%. And correlation is also a very weak correlation, and we can see that correlation is, we strongly say that we have certain categories for correlation, and we say that we divide our correlation as by saying that how many correlation values we have, certain categories to understand whether it is weakly, moderately or strongly associated. So there are different books are saying, but normally what we do, we say that zero indicates no correlation. Anything which is greater than 0.1 and which is less than 0.4, we say that it is weakly associated. 0.4 to 0.6 or 7, you can consider it as it is strongly moderately associated. 0.7 above and till 0.9 something, then it is strongly associated. And if the correlation value is 1, then it is going to give me perfect correlation. So these are the few categories, and you will find that this is available in book also. And I can calculate correlation. I can go for regression from the same regression, same plot. And this scatter plot can tell me about the relationship between, because you can see that there is a trend line which I have added, and this trend line can be I can edit this trend line. I can go for different charts. So charts are very essential to understand the correlation. Now you will, if you'll have a data which is rightly scaled or measured on right unit of measurements, and then definitely you will get a very good results here. And if a variable really they to have any association, so definitely it will result in the correlation. So this is how we go for correlation analysis. Now we are going for next as a regression. I want to show you, I already showed how to go for a regression from correlation plot. But there's an option in data, and I can go for regression. So I can click on data. Then this is data analysis. Then there's an option to be called as regression. You can see that it allows me to go for regression. Is regression. Okay. What is my dependent? Again, my dependent is a difference. What about my independent? Independent is Now it is average number of customers, so it is D. And I have labels. I don't, if I want a confidence interval, I will put it. Otherwise, I don't require confidence interval. Then I will deselect it. Output I want in the same worksheet. And I don't want residuals. Residuals are nothing but it is predicted values. Y cap minus Y is to be called as residuals. That means your actual value, difference of actual value and predicted value is to be called as a residual. But at basic level, if you want to understand this, I will not take you to the advanced level or to more analysis of these residuals, line feed plots, and because regression will require a lot of time to understand this. But I'm just giving you option that this is how we can go for regression, and you will get a regression option here. These are the three essential things that one should know. You can verify that this p-value, this r-square value, which we have generated in correlation, also the same r-square value is here. That means my r-square is right. Okay, and same data I'm using, that's why r-square is here. Multiple correlation, because only two variables are here. So it is the correlation value. You can see that the correlation value is 0.28375, and the same value I'm going to get here. So it is correlation. Then adjusted R square is, we don't have to bother about, but only we have to think about this R square. This R square should be very strong, as if it is approaching towards one, then my model is very. Yesterday I was telling that many of us are interested to find out a predictive model. In that case, we will require to have this R square to be very strong and very close to one, so that everyone can accept that model. Again, these are called as model fit parameters. Then this is a p-value. Can I use my model for predictions? Yes, I can use, because my p-value, ANOVA says that this model is okay to use for prediction. But R-square is very big. So I can say that whatever X I'm using is not sufficient to find out the change in the Y. I may require some more variables to find out the change in Y. But that change because of X is very small, and that is only 8%. But still, if I know X, I can use this model to say something about the profit change in the values of the retailers. Now, what about these two? These are my coefficients. You can see my coefficient. This is actually we are requiring coefficients. This is only, these are the two values. And here we require its p value. Okay. And that too we bother about this one, not of intercept, and we say that what is my, whether my independent variable adds to a dependent variable up to significantly or not. So definitely my p value is less than 0.05, and it is adding to my dependent variable Y, that is difference in the profit. And definitely we can say that this positive value of the coefficient indicate that change average 2.25 change in customers, that is one unit change in one customer. If I am adding one customer, then my profit is expected to change by 2.25 units. That means I am adding one customer, since positive coefficient indicates that it is going to add into profit. Negative coefficient is going to talk about it will decrease the value. So we have to interpret these values, and there are so many things which we can do. Then the last point which I'm going to talk is about chi-square. I know that I'm running out of time, and again I'm running out of that means I'm running in my session. But I don't think that to understand all these tests and in detail about their interpretation and everything using in 1.5 hours, it is not possible. But we tried that. We thought that we should at least introduce you. And then by taking help of many of the sessions, I also have my other sessions of non-parametric. So you can go for non-parametric data also, find out other sessions of mine where you will be able to get information on non-parametric and detailed understanding of every test. So every test, its interpretation and everything is available on YouTube. Or you can ask me that if you want, I will provide you information on that. That's for all the test. Now this is something we are calling it as chi-square test. I want to test stress is independent of region of working and stress is not independent of region of working. So if stress is independent of region of working, that means my variable is stress and region is the other variable. So what I did, I have categorized my data. Again, I have used pivot table system. And now pivot table system, I have this data. This is my observed frequency. I have calculated expected frequency. The formula for expected frequency is total of the row. That means this one is, if you see that if I calculate it, if I want to calculate, let us say that then I will calculate this is equals to this particular value, that is the row total into column total and divided by the grand total. So I get a value. This is how we calculate, and we calculate respectively for every cell. So I have 6 observed values, so I will have 6 expected value. This is a table of observed values. This is the table of observed value, and then this is the table of expected value. Expected value, observed and expected. Now I generated. I have generated observed and expected, and I can calculate my p value. What I'm using here is a chi-square. You can see that I'm using. I will write equal to. There is no option in the data for chi-square, so it is chi-square. I don't know, but if some new Excel are providing it, but I don't think that none of the Excels. We'll use chi-square test, okay, and this returns a p-value. Now, I will select actual range. So please ignore all the table headings and row headings or column headings and select only a data between these two, that means 51 to 48 is first. Okay, please see that I have selected data. And the next one is, I want to select expected range. So this is my expected range. And then I will close bracket properly and I will calculate p value. What about chi-square value? Chi-square, this gives me, this is the right tailed p value. Understand, this is right tailed p value. So I want to calculate chi-square value also. How to calculate chi-square value? It is equals to chi-square distribution dot RT. Okay, I will select this as X, comma. You will find number of, how to calculate degrees of freedom, 3 columns and 2 rows. So 3 minus 1 into 2 minus 1. So it is 2 into 1. So it is 2. Sorry, I think I have used the right tilde. I have to use inverse. It is not distribution. Please. Sorry for that. Instead of this distribution, we want inverse. Okay. It is chi-square. Let us see. Please. Chi-square inverse RT. Okay. Sorry. This is chi-square inverse RT. And it will ask probability. So this is my probability value. Okay, and degrees of freedom is 2. So I will get value, and that is 0.82. You can verify these values. And this is all about your chi-square. And this p-value is greater than 0.05. So we retain our null hypothesis, and we say that stress is independent of region of working. And this is how we can go for Excel. We can do so many things in Excel. For everyone now, everyone is savvy of smartphone, as we were not able to do anything with the smartphone at the beginning. But as we have practiced on smartphone, every day we are using it. So we have started using it very fluently, efficiently. The same thing happens with Excel. There are few add-ons. We call it as real statistics. Is add-on, which is to be called as real statistics, which allows you to do a lot of analysis in the Excel. This is all about your Excel. So if you have any query, any question, you can raise. I think this video will be with you, so definitely you can raise any question, you can even write to me. I will share my email ID. It is sakjram.muly@kccollege.edu.in. My email ID. All small, it has taken capital, so too small. You can write. I will definitely try to answer your queries. And let us say thank you. I hope that we are a bit 15 minutes late, but still we have finished it out. Please convey, because we have tried this session to cover so many things, and it is very difficult to cover, but still we tried it, so that at least I am not saying that you will be expert after this session, but at least you will have some hold on your that you will it will give you some confidence that I can do something in Excel. If I have a small data, then I can, instead of just running here and there, I can do some basic analysis using Excel. And definitely that is a need of a time also, because now every teacher, everyone who is doing some research is expected to present somewhere. And just because people get stuck because of these basic things for their analysis, and because of these basics, now they can do some certain analysis, and at least they will be able to generate graphs, tables, and some additional statistical analysis or statistical test. Sometimes at the beginning we may make a mistake, we'll make a mistake, but what is the basic idea, that at least once your hands started working on this Excel, definitely will find the other ways or other means to do this. Thank you.
Sir, thank you. There were a few questions. Shall I read them out to you?
Yeah, absolutely.
One was, is Excel better or SPSS is better?
It is a very obvious question, and everyone say that which software I should use. But now the difference between Excel and SPSS is, SPSS is a paid version, and you have to buy SPSS package and then you can use it. But Excel is available on everyone's PC. It comes with comes as an Microsoft Office. We are buying it, but that is the requirement of MS Office. We are buying MS Office, and definitely because we are using Word and all other packages of MS Office. So Excel comes with that. And for basic analysis, I will suggest you, for graphs and basic tables and basic analysis, even for data cleaning, I will suggest you to go for Excel. But for advanced analysis, you have to shift on SPSS. So because SPSS is specially designed software for data analysis purpose, so definitely SPSS will give you a lot of things which is a extra. Here we have to generate those things. We can generate that, but there we will get it automatically. So that is the difference between SPSS and Excel. So if SPSS is available, definitely I will ask you that if you have a lot of data, variables, lot of analysis to be done, very advanced analysis to be done, then I will suggest you to go for definitely for SPSS. Otherwise, very small data set, small number of variables, very few comparisons to be done, then Excel is the best option. That's why I'm asking you to start with Excel and shift on some SPSS. Or there is another package, we call it as R package. R is free version, free software, which is available. So you can go for R also. Next question, if any.
Yes, sir. Another was, what is critical value and P value?
Critical value is a table value, and P value is a probability value. And using that critical value only, we calculate P value.
Professor Sandeep Singh wanted to ask you, what is the difference between SEM and SED?
SE M.
M and S E D.
With reference to what he's asking?
No, the question was only this much difference between SEM and SED.
Because there are SEM is a structural equation. If he's asking from the perspective of some statistical techniques, then SED maybe, because I don't know what in what context he's asking.
Yeah, he did not give context.
But SEM.
Okay.
So that is it is in case of with respect to descriptive statistics, it is SEM stands for standard error of mean, and SED mm-hmm. stands for square root standard error of a difference. Okay.
Okay.
But if he has other context of using a technique, then SEM stands for structural equation modeling. So he has to mention it very precisely that what context he's asking.
Okay. Another professor, Akansha Pandey, wants to ask you about complete randomized block design.
She's talking about CRD, but CRD is not a part of our discussion today. It is
okay.
A planning of experiments. That means it is a part of planning of experiments. So it will take a time to discuss about completely randomized design. But I will tell her that it is,
okay.
If suppose you have some 20 experimental units, and if you want to apply three treatments, then randomly you are selecting samples for applying the treatment. That is a completely randomized design. There is no segregation, but that is a part of design and analysis of experiment. So that is prior to doing analysis, we plan our experiment, and then we can think of doing analysis.
Okay. Another question now popped up is, how do we generate random number series generation?
The option in Excel. Excel
yes.
allows you to generate random numbers, and there's an option which is to be called as random between. If you'll just click equal to and just R A N D, so you can generate random numbers, and it allows you to give a range between some numbers that minimum to maximum you can give, and you can generate some random numbers. This is one option. And other is that if you have some distribution based random number generations or random sample generation, then that option is also available in Excel.
Yes. So now I'll ask Sheetal ma'am to carry on with the session. Thank you, Sheetal.
Thank you, ma'am.
So good evening, sir.
Good evening, ma'am.
Sir,
nice to see you.
I understand. Sir, I am falling short of words today. What should I use? I don't know. Should I use it amazing, wonderful, incredible? I'm really falling short of words, sir, today. It was such an insightful session that I am so, so proud, sir. And I completely believe that we have today concluded with our FDP. The comprehending of the knowledge, everything that we could do, we have finished. But the effect, we're just going to begin now, sir. I think with your knowledge that you have shared with our participants, I think now will be applied, will be utilized, will be analyzed. And I think we are doing it for a wider set of people today. And I'm really amazed of your skills, sir. As I always say, I always said yesterday that, you know, a good statistician doesn't require any introduction. I think his skills talks it. And I think today your skill, your knowledge, your expertise has done all the jobs, sir. And I really want to thank you, Mule, sir, for making our FDP so, so successful, sir. I am really, really grateful, sir.
Great. Thank you, ma'am.
A few instructions for the participants. We have not winded up. Mule sir, I would request you to be in the panel for some time before for the concluding session. Instructions to the participants. instructions of the feedback form and the certificate will be given to you at the end. It will not be posted in the WhatsApp group. So I would request that you please be on the platform for few minutes more so that we can have the concluding session by a principal, ma'am. So over to you, Sarita. Ma'am can take over.
Good evening to all. It is my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on the occasion of the Faculty Development Program on Research Methodologies, Statistical Testing, and Data Analysis using MS Excel. It is fair to conclude that Faculty Development Program was a great success. I thank for all the great innovative input and for fruitful discussions by distinguished speakers and participants. Dear participants, I want to impress upon you that the end of learning is not knowledge, but enlightenment. Aim of all kind of education must be pure fountain of learning and knowledge. Only the scholars receive universal respect and not the rulers. As it is said that, Swadeshe Pujyate Raja Vidwan Sarvatra Pujyate. King is respected only in his kingdom, but scholar is respected everywhere. They say knowledge is a power, but it is in fact power of character which transforms face of society. Education must add ethical values to our life. Knowledge must make us humble. Our ancient wisdom says that Vidya Vinayena Shobhate. Humbleness versus knowledge. In my opinion, there are three aspects of education. Firstly, higher of the education, higher should be the degree of humbleness of humanity. Secondly, education must inspire a person to spread knowledge. And thirdly, education must develop capacity and capability. The word education is derived from Latin word edico. It means I laid out. This should remain motto of your life. All of you have to play an important role in intellectual, social, and cultural development of the society for transforming personalities of students. Wish you all the best, my dear participants. I want to give you the brief introduction of Tilak Education Society. Tilak Education Society is established in 1984 with the aim of promoting education. It was registered under the Society Act and also registered under Public Trust 1950. The society is engaged in educational activities from nursery to post-graduation level in Navi Mumbai. Today, society runs 20 institutions in 4 different educational complexes in Navi Mumbai, catering to the educational need of 15,000 students in Navi Mumbai. Our vision is to develop world-class institution for holistic development of individuals involving academic excellence, professional competence, human values, and social skills to empower students to become leaders capable of facing future challenges. Our motto is nurturing tomorrow's mind. The college running 7 different courses, Bachelor of Computer Science, BSCCS, Bachelor of Information Technology, BSCIT, Bachelor of Biotechnology, Bachelor of Mass Media, that is BMM, Bachelor of Management and Studies, BMS, Bachelor of Commerce, BCom, and Bachelor of Banking and Insurance. All courses are affiliated to University of Mumbai. Education to all is our objective. We set high standards of academic excellency. We organize leadership training programs, seminars, workshops for the students on different topics. We believe in nurturing a cohesive society by encouraging students. This is possible because of management is highly supportive for overall development of staff and student. I would like to express my sincere thanks to our chairman, Shri Jain Kurup sir, chairman of Tilak Education Society, for providing encouragement and support. Thank you, sir. I also wish to express my gratitude to Dr. Ajit Kurup sir, secretary of Tilak Education Society, for providing encouragement for this program. Thank you, sir. I must mention my deep appreciation to Arun Kurup sir, director of Tilak Education Society, for his guidance and support. Thank you very much, sir. I am also very grateful to Registrar Suresh sir and Administrator Sri Anil Nayar sir for all kind of technical support. Well, an event like this cannot happen overnight. The wheel starts rolling before 2 weeks ago. It requires planning and bird's eye for details. We have been fortunate enough backed by a team of very motivated and dedicated colleagues of College of Science and Commerce. I'm very thankful to my committee members, Mrs. Sheetal Aditya, Mrs. Chanchal Kaur, and Mrs. Sarita Balakrishnan. I would like to thanks to Dr. Shraddha Bhume Madam from Satish Pradhan Gnan Sadhana College Thane for her insightful and stimulating session. Your comments were specially helpful to those doing research, and your talk seemed to provide much needed help. Thank you, madam. I would like to express my deep appreciation to Dr. Mule sir from KC College, Churchgate, for your inspiring presentation. Your years of research, your depth of knowledge to present the topic in such an interesting way produced most memorable for statistical hypothesis. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, sir, for interesting, informative, and delightful session. I take this opportunity to extend my sincere thanks to all the eminent scholars and invited guests who have attended this faculty development program for their cooperation and support. I thank them for their minute-to-minute support and guidance, for the encouraging at every point of time for this program. Once again, I would like to thank all the participants. It is your ability that all you made this faculty development program successful. Finally, I would like to thank the entire well-wisher for commitment and support. Sarva Nitivanta Gunavanta Kirtivanta Shilavanta प्राध्यापकांना माझ्या मनपूर्वक शुभेच्छा. त्यांनी जीवनात खूप प्रगती करून पुढे जावे ही ईश्वरचरणी प्रार्थना करते आणि इथेच संपवते. वंदे मातरम, जय महाराष्ट्र. थँक्यू व्हेरी मच.
श्रद्धा मॅम, यू वॉन्ट टू से समथिंग? मुले सर, यू वॉन्ट टू शेअर समथिंग?
मुले सर, आधी बोला तुम्ही.
Sir, audio.
It was my pleasure that when I got an invitation for this FDP, then I saw that Shraddha madam is there at the beginning. So it was really a very good that she will start, and definitely she will make it very easy for me on the next day. So that's why it was really to be with Shraddha madam for this particular FDP. And I thank you, Tilak Education Society, and even Principal Madam Anita Joshi Madam, Sheetal Madam, Chanchal Madam, Sarita Madam. As you know that we have gone for 3-4 dry runs, and I was a bit worried about today's session because I was trying to go for Excel. I was trying to do something which is new. Even I had a dry run in the morning, I was again trying to do something new, that I will use mobile and then laptop. So, but it worked, and everything as madam said, that it has started with Ganesh Vandana. So definitely the Ganesha has to take it at the end. and it is not our responsibility. So it was the responsibility of God Ganesha to make this session successful. And thank you to everyone.
Hello. Yeah, I would like to share something about this FDP and the idea behind this. Am I audible properly?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So first and foremost, I would like to thank Tier Education Society for, you know, taking such a wonderful idea, you know, doing analysis through Excel, through online mode, in front of all the participants. And that is the FDP which has not taken place in any college so far in all the FDPs, whatever they have, you know, organized. Many have taken 5 days FDP on all the theoretical aspects. But I must congratulate you for this wonderful theme which you have innovated. So special thanks to Principal Ma'am Anita Joshi, then Coordinator Sheetal Aditya Ma'am, Chanchal Ma'am and Sarita Ma'am for all technical support, all the help to, you know, make us learn how to go to StreamYard and then how to go live. Extremely fabulous and entirely, you know, I can say a great team effort. And yes, Murali sir, I have just taught them theory, but I know you were there for practical part. So definitely Excel must be rocked with you for all the 2 days. Thank you again, all the participants, for so many views and subscription to the YouTube channel. Thank you for, again, I'm getting personal messages that ma'am, session was good. Ma'am, you made me live and all. I'm really happy and really thankful to all for all the wonderful 3 days with you all, then also showering me so many, you know, good comments from your side. Really, really thanks. Thanks for all, ma'am. Thank you so much. And Murali sir, it has been always a great pleasure to be associated with you. Such a knowledgeable person with statistics and so down to earth. Thank you once again, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Absolutely, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you.
God bless you all.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.